नमस्ते बिटिया, माई सेल्फ जेवियन नेहा सैनी फ्रॉम फिजियोथेरेपी एंड डायग्नोस्टिक्स। हेयर आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू अबाउट द एनाटमी ऑफ द फोर्थ वेंट्रिकल। द ब्रेन डेवलप्स फ्रॉम द एनलार्ज क्रेनियल पार्ट ऑफ द न्यूरल ट्यूब। एट द एंड ऑफ द फोर्थ वीक द एनलार्ज थेफेलिक पार्ट शोज थ्री डिस्टिंक्ट डायलेटेशंस। द प्राइमरी ब्रेन वेजिकल्स, द कैविटी ऑफ दीज वेजिकल्स फॉर्म वेंट्रिकुलर सिस्टम ऑफ द अडल्ट ब्रेन। So this is the ventricular system of adult brain. In this, the colored areas, the blue colored and the red colored areas, these are the ventricles. These are the spaces which are containing the CSF. So primary brain vesicles are craniocaudally. Foremost is the prosencephalon. Below that we have mesencephalon. Then lowermost part is the rhombencephalon. That is the hindbrain. So these are the primary brain structures which are forming the adult brain. So this is the ventricular system which lies in the brain, adult brain. Now the CSF, it is similar to that of the blood plasma and the interstitial fluid. It is present in the ventricular system within the CNS and in the subarachnoid space surrounding the CNS. It baths both the external and internal surfaces of the brain and the spinal cord. It provides a protective cushion between the CNS and the surrounding bones. In an adult, the total volume of CSF is about 150 ml, out of which 30 ml is in the ventricular system and remainder in the subarachnoid space. So here we can see the flow of CSF in our ventricular system. So the one point indicates the secretion of the CSF from the choroid plexus of the lateral ventricle. So foremost secretion is done in the lateral ventricles. From here it is transferred to the other ventricles of the brain, and then ultimately it is reabsorbed in the venous system by the arachnoid villi. So in the diagram we can see the flow of the CSF. The arrow marked is the transfer of CSF, flow of CSF in the ventricular system, and then ultimately it reaches to the arachnoid villus. Then this is the fourth ventricle, which is lying between the cerebellum behind and the pons and the medulla oblongata on the anterior side. So here we discuss about the fourth ventricle. It is a tent like cavity of the hindbrain. The site, that is the location, is in the posterior cranial fossa, and it is lying anterior to the cerebellum. That is, cerebellum is lying posterior to it, and the pons and the upper part of medulla lies in front of it. It lies with the ependyma and is filled with CSF. So here we can see the superior surface of the cerebellum, and this is the inferior view of the cerebellum. And here it lies, the cerebellum, on the posterior part of the fourth ventricle. Then the cavity of the ventricle presents, it is triangular in outline in sagittal section, and it is rhomboidal in shape in the horizontal section. It is continuous with the cerebral aqueduct of midbrain and central canal of the medulla oblongata. So here we can see, this is the floor of fourth ventricle. Above it is continuous with the midbrain, and below with the spinal cord, that is the central canal of the spinal cord. Fourth ventricle has recesses, angles, openings, floor, roof. Then we come to the applied anatomy of the fourth ventricle. So there are four angles in the fourth ventricle: superior, inferior, and two lateral angles. Superior angle is continuous above with the cerebral aqueduct of the midbrain, that is the opening in the midbrain, and inferiorly it is continuous with the central canal of the spinal cord, that is the closed part of the medulla oblongata. Then laterally there are two lateral openings in the fourth ventricle, one on each side, and is carried outwards across the dorsal surface of the inferior cerebral peduncle as tubular pouches known as lateral recesses. So here we can see the boundaries of the fourth ventricle, that is, inferior laterally it is bounded by the gracile and the cuneate tubercles, Here we can see this is the gracile tubercle, and lateral to it this is the cuneate tubercle, and then we have the inferior cerebellar peduncle. Inferior cerebellar peduncle connects the cerebellum to the brainstem. Then superolaterally means this part. Superolaterally there is superior cerebellar peduncle which is connecting the cerebellum to the brainstem. And laterally we have the lateral recesses. Then we come to the roof or the posterior wall. It is tent shaped. It has upper, lower sloping surfaces. The apex is extend into the white core of the cerebellum. So in the image we can see this is the roof. It is tent shaped and the apex is inserting into the white core of the cerebellum. Upper part of the roof is formed by the superior cerebellar peduncles and a thin sheet of white matter bridging the superior cerebellar peduncles. So the upper part is formed by the superior cerebellar peduncle and the superior medullary vellum. Here it lies the roof. So roof in the upper part is formed by the superior cerebellar peduncle. This is the upper part. And in the caudal part it is formed by the inferior medullary vellum. Inferior medullary vellum is nothing but the fold of the pia mater. Then we have three apertures in the roof, that is, one is the median aperture. This is the median aperture in the midline, and these are the two lateral apertures along the lateral angles, and these are known as foramina of Lushka. The median aperture is known as foramina of Meggendy. Then medullary vellum. It bridges the triangular gap between the two cerebellar peduncles, superior and the inferior. Here we can see this is the superior and this is the inferior medullary vellum. Superior medullary vellum bridges the triangular gap between the superior cerebellar peduncles and it is made up of nervous tissue. Superior cerebellar peduncles are nothing but the nerve fibers which connect the cerebellum to the brainstem on the upper side. And the inferior cerebellar peduncle, it is nothing but the nerve fibers which connecting the cerebellum to the lower part of the brainstem. So inferior medullary vellum is formed conjointly by the ventricular ependymion and the pia mater of the tela choroidea, and it is made up of non-nervous tissue. The roof in the lower part is formed by the inferior medullary vellum, as we have discussed earlier, which is a non-nervous tissue intimately related to the nodule of the inferior vernus of the cerebellum. And this part, inferior medullary vellum, is related to the which part of cerebellum? That is the nodule of the cerebellum. Then in the roof we have foramen of Meggendy. It is a large aperture in the median plane in the lower part of the inferior medullary vellum, through which the cavity of the fourth ventricle communicates with the subarachnoid space of the cerebellomedullary cistern, that is the cisterna magna. So here we can see the relation of the nodule in the inferior medullary vellum, and this is the foramen of Meggendy. Then tela choroidea. It is a double layer fold of pia mater. It lies between inferior vermis of the cerebellum and the lower part of the roof of fourth ventricle. So here we can see the tela choroidea. Then we have choroid plexus. It is formed by the capillary plexus of the blood vessels between the two layers of tela choroidea. So tela choroidea is nothing but the fold of pia mater, and choroid plexus, these are the capillary plexus derived from the branches of posterior inferior cerebellar arteries. So the choroid plexus in case of fourth ventricle derives from pica, that is posterior inferior cerebellar arteries. Choroid plexus in the fourth ventricle is T-shaped, capital T-shaped, and projects into the cavity through the lower part of the roof. It has a vertical limb which is a double, with the foramen of Meggendy intervening between the two limbs. As we can see in the diagram, this is the vertical limb and it is having intervening foramen of Meggendy, and these are the two horizontal limbs on either side extend into the lateral recesses, and they will lead to the foramen of Lushka through the lateral apertures. Then the floor, it is important. Floor is known as rhomboid fossa because it is rhomboid in shape, diamond shape, and it is formed by the posterior surface of the pons and upper part of the medulla. It is divisible into three parts, upper part and the lower triangular part. Upper part is formed by the posterior surface of the pons, lower triangular part is formed by the upper part of the posterior surface of the medulla, and the intermediate part, it is the junction of medulla and the pons. It is prolonged laterally on either side over the inferior cerebellar peduncle as the floor of lateral recess. So here we can see the floor of the rhomboid fossa, that is the floor of the fourth ventricle. In the floor we have some important sulci, we have some important eminences and structures. These are median sulcus. It divides the floor into right and the left symmetrical halves. It lies in the midline. Then medial eminence, it is a longitudinal elevation on either side of the median sulcus. Then sulcus limitans, median eminence is bounded literally by sulcus limitans. So these areas are included in this diagram. Here we can see the median sulcus in the midline. Then lateral to it, we have the median eminence. And median eminence is bounded by the sulcus limitans. Here is we have the sulcus limitans. Then in the upper part we have facial colliculus, which is formed by the facial nucleus, facial nerve fibers. And then we have vestibular area, which is giving origin to the eighth cranial nerve. Then in the lower triangular part we have hypoglossal triangle. Here lies the nucleus for hypoglossal nerve, that is the 12th cranial nerve. Then we have the superior cerebellar peduncle in the upper part, inferior cerebellar peduncle in the lower part. Then lateral to the hypoglossal triangle we have vagal triangle. Vagal triangle is giving origin to the nerve fibers of the vagus nerve, that is the 10th cranial nerve. Then the inferior most part is the area postrema. Area postrema is the vomiting center in the brain stem. Then the apex of the floor is known as obex. So these are the different structures which are lying in the floor of the fourth ventricle. So here are the table. We have given summary in which part we have which nucleus and which is controlling the different parts of our body. For example, beneath the superior half of the floor we have abducens nucleus. Abducens nucleus means the nucleus which is giving origin to the sixth cranial nerve. And we have vestibular nuclei, which is giving origin to the 8th cranial nerve. Beneath the inferior half of the floor, we have vestibular nucleus, dorsal nucleus of vagus, nucleus intercalatus, true vomiting centers and vital centers of our body. Then we have locus ceruleus in the floor of the 4th ventricle. It is a bluish gray area which lies above the superior fovea where the sulcus limitans flattens out. The color is imparted by underlying group of the nerve cells containing melanin pigment which constitute substantia ferruginea. The neurons of the locus ceruleus contain large quantities of norepinephrine. So this locus ceruleus has important function in the stress. Then in the inferior fovea we have lowermost part of sulcus limitans, which is presenting a small depression. Then facial colliculus is what? It is a oval swelling present on either side of the medial eminence in the pontine part of the floor at the level of superior fovea. This swelling is produced by the fibers from the motor nucleus of the facial nerve hooking around the abducens nucleus. Abducens nucleus means nucleus of the sixth cranial nerve. And this hook is known as the internal genu of facial nerve. Genu means bending. Then the medullary part of the floor, that is the lower part, it form the inferior fovea to the sulcus limitans descend obliquely towards the median sulcus. Sulcus divides the medial eminence into two triangles, that is hypoglossal triangle above and vagal triangle below. So here we can see the hypoglossal triangle and the vagal triangle clearly. This is the hypoglossal triangle and this is the vagal triangle below. Hypoglossal triangle overlies the hypoglossal nucleus, that is the 12th cranial nerve nucleus, and vagal triangle overlies the dorsal nucleus of vagus, that is the nucleus of the 10th cranial nerve. Then lateral to them we have vestibular triangle, which is overlying the nucleus of the 8th cranial nerve. Then we have area postrema. It is a small area between the unicorus apparens above and the gracile tubercle below. In the diagram we can see the area postrema, and it consists of highly vascular neuroglial tissue. It does not possess the blood-brain barrier. That is why it is the vomiting center. Any chemical can irritate this area. Then we have the tinea. Tinea is what? This is the tinea. It is the inferior lateral margins of the fourth ventricle, which is marked by a narrow white ridge. The two tinea meet at the apex, that is the apex of the floor of the fourth ventricle. Obex is the roof of inferior angle of the fourth ventricle. Then we have recesses of the fourth ventricle. There are total 5 recesses in the fourth ventricle. Recesses are what? These are the extensions from the cavity. So recesses are the extension of fourth ventricle. There are 2 lateral recesses, 1 median dorsal recess and 2 lateral dorsal recesses. Lateral recesses are on each side. It lies in the interval between the lateral or angles, and it opens into the subarachnoid space of cerebellopontine angle, that is CP angle, as the lateral aperture, that is the foramen of Lushka, through which part of choroid plexus bulges out. So here we can see again the floor and the lateral recesses of the fourth ventricle. Here again we can see the lateral recesses. Then median dorsal recess, it extends into the white core of the cerebellum in the midline. Then the 2 lateral dorsal recesses, 1 on each side of median dorsal recess, it projects dorsally above the inferior medullary vellum. So this is dorso median and dorso lateral recess. Then the openings in the fourth ventricle, we have total 5 openings through which the CSF can leave the fourth ventricle. In the central aperture we have the foramen of Magendie, and the 2 lateral apertures in the roof, that is foramen of Lushka, the central canal below which communicates with the medulla oblongata, and the cerebral aqueduct above of midbrain. Then come to the applied, we have medulloblastoma. It is the most common tumor in this region, mostly occurs in children. It arises from poorly differentiated primitive neuroectodermal cells of cerebellar vermis, and it is highly malignant and produces the signs and symptoms of cerebellar lesions, or it may press upon the vital centers located beneath the floor of the fourth ventricle and causing cardiac irregularities, tachycardia, irregular respiration and vasomotor disturbances. So here we can see the medulloblastoma. Then hydrocephalus. It is an abnormal increase in the volume of the CSF within the skull. If the hydrocephalus is accompanied by a raised CSF pressure, then it is due to one of the following reasons. First, an abnormal increase in the formation of fluid or blockage in the circulation of CSF or diminished absorption of the fluid. So rarely hydrocephalus occurs with a normal CSF pressure, and in these patients there is a compensatory hyperplasia or atrophy of the brain substance. So here we can see the hydrocephalic ventricles in which the ventricles get enlarged because of the hydrocephalus. This is again image of the hydrocephalic head. Then come to the questions which are important as per this topic. So first question is, write short note on floor of the fourth ventricle. So in this you have to draw and explain all the structures which are occurring in the floor of the fourth ventricle. Then the second question is, write short note on boundaries of fourth ventricle. So here you have to write about the all the boundaries, that is the superior inferior boundaries, the roof and the floor of the fourth ventricle. So this is a large question. Then in the exercise you have to draw these diagrams, these well labeled diagrams in your files as your task for the fourth ventricle. So this completes our topic, the fourth ventricle. Thank you.